Right, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this evening's meeting of the Cabinet. First of all, the normal housekeeping arrangements, fire evacuation proceedings, no fire alarms this evening. If one sounds, then let's all go and leave the building immediately. Fire exits are located at the side and rear of this room, and down the stairs we go and off to War Memorial Park. Just note, please, that the meeting's being webcast. I assume it is working because I can see the pictures, but it does say here I have to check with you to make sure that it is. And can we all make sure that our phones are not on twinkle or vibrate or anything like that that's likely to vibrate on the desks? Good. Then apologies for absence, we have none. Declarations of interest. Anybody got any interest they wish to declare on any item for this evening? No. Urgent matters, we have none for consideration. Then the minutes of the previous meeting, which was held on the 16th of May. You all had copies in the agenda there. Any comments to make, any changes, points of accuracy, omissions, in which case I will sign those later on when we get to them. then we'll move to the main items on the agenda. Before we do, I think it's only appropriate to have a couple of words about Brexit and the current situation that we find ourselves in. For the record, it would be rather peculiar if we were to have a meeting of Cabinet and not to comment upon it. And I think the one thing to be said at the stage is that nobody knows what the impact of Brexit is going to be on us as far as being a council. It is very early days yet. There is still enormous volatility in the markets, so from a financial point of view, it becomes difficult to make any projections. Anything that we do say is only our own guess at what the situation might be. Equally, politically, there is a change of leadership potentially due in the two major parties, anyway, in the country, and what the impact of that may be in the fullness of time on government policy as it affects local government is difficult to prejudge at this stage. I think the only thing that one can realistically say is that the likelihood is that the financial situation will not get perceivably better as far as local government is concerned. The likelihood is that there will be less money, at least in the short to medium term, coming into public finance from tax revenue, etc. And that inevitably finds its way down to us in local government in one way or another. And that may have all sorts of implications, which again, I think it's just too early to even start to speculate on. The only note to that is that we are and have been recognised as being one of the most resilient councils in the country in terms of our investment, and the way that we receive our money is such that we are probably better able than most to withstand an immediate shock or even a medium-term pressure upon our budget and our ability to deliver. That said, it doesn't mean to say that it's going to be easy for anybody in this environment, but we will continue to do the best that we can given the circumstances, and I think that's probably as much as one can realistically say about Brexit at this moment. So let us move on then to the first item, which ironically enough is to talk about Treasury management and the annual outturn report for 2015-16. And the Cabinet Member for Finance, Service Delivery and Improvement.
Thank you, Leader. The report in front of you is the Treasury Management Outturn Report, as you say, for the end of March. And the key points really within this are that at a period of time where already interest rates are less than we forecast, There is continuing pressure, obviously, to perform within the Treasury Management Group. And overall, with an overall return of 1.8% against an estimate of 1.86%, we have, during the year, maintained a very strong performance. However, in a little bit more detail, the net interest investment income has come in at 68K below plan. That forecast will be met by the interest risk reserve, which was set up to deal with in-year variances, though it is fair to say that the forecast for the year-end also was declined in December 2015 by some £350,000, from £3.5 million to £3.15 million. So it has come in below forecast, but it will be met from the interest rate reserve. And similarly, income from strategic investments is 61K lower. Our externally managed funds performed less well than we would have expected, and some income from operation investments also at 48,000 was lower than expected. So overall, it's a climate where we are performing more or less to the forecast, but it's becoming increasingly pressured. And it's also worth adding within that that we are also performing in a much better way compared to comparable authorities, and with one of the lowest level of credit risks within that. So it is worth, I think, bringing forward the fact that the Treasury Management team, at a time we are finding it difficult to meet the returns that we're forecasting, are achieving more or less the goals that were set. Looking forward, you mentioned about Brexit, it is increasingly likely that the forecasts for interest rates that were made even maybe a month or so ago, even less than that actually, probably a week or so ago, are under pressure, and that will also then need to be part of our forecasting and budgeting for the year ahead. But as it is at the moment, we are well managed, we're performing better than most, with lower risk, but we will need to do more to maintain that performance in the coming year.
Thank you very much. Anybody else anything to say? Otherwise, I think the recommendation is that we recommend to Council to note the annual report of Treasury Management, including the prudential indicators, actual for 2015-16, and secondly, and quite importantly, I think, that the capital financing requirement and the minimum revenue provision requirement are both nil, which is, again, attests to the solidity of our economic situation. Happy with that? Good. Then let us move forward to the second outturn report, which deals with the other side of the balance sheet, the revenue side of it. Councillor Tait.
Thank you, Leader. Again, in summary, revenue outturn report, we have an expenditure at 99.8% of plan and income at 100.8%. So from a point of view, our revenue outturn is positive in some 626,000. So overall, a well-structured and well-managed outturn at the end of the year. After carry-forwards, which request is 137,000, there are four programs within those carry-forwards, which is planting in town centre areas, contributions to homelessness budget, housing strategy, and also to youth hub feasibility. In addition to that, 325,000 will be allocated to the interest risk reserve to rebuild, and the surplus of 163,000 will be recommended to provide additional budget for strategic budgets, which includes many down the leisure park and the corporate governance. So from this, you can see that it's managed well according to the forecast, slightly higher in income, and expenditure has been well managed, which allows us then to take on some of the additional things. The main capital program achievements for last year, there were 40 capital schemes which were authorized, of which in addition to 202 mandatory disabled facilities grants, there was £262,000 to existing satisfactory purchases, and a further 8 projects for parking were completed, and another 9 are in frame to be done. In total, nearly 100 new spaces and 20 drop curbs. So overall, again, in terms of our achievement, it is close to the budget level in terms of the planning and also very, very inability to produce a positive outturn, allowing us to take on some of the more pleasing things that many councils would find difficult to do at this particular moment. So the coming year, again, going back to what I said about Treasury, the same will be true, that we will be looking to manage very effectively both the revenue that we have as well as the capital outturn. So the coming year is not going to be any easier, but with the same team and the way we're going forward, hopefully we can achieve both the same level of outcome with the same level of projects in the future.
Any points anybody wishes to raise? Because the recommendation is slightly more complex here, in that we do have a net surplus of 626,000 on the revenue outturn, against which there are a number of carry forward requests which are contained in the report, and also contributions to and from reserves which we need to recommend to council as part of our recommendation, having considered this report. And there are also to note that there's a number of ongoing revenue impacts that have been identified, and these will be included in the budget monitoring reports for 16-17 and the strategy for 17-18. And also to note that the capital outturn, and to agree that the revised capital programme, which is detailed in Appendix 8, which actually just moves a number of things backwards and forwards within that programme. So there's some quite a bit of detail in there, which I don't propose that we rehearse at this particular stage. The only point I think to say is that a net surplus, given the total of 626,000, given the total that we've been working towards, is within, well, I think anybody would regard that as being well within a statistical margin of error for forecasting, and is, of course, on the positive side, which is also a good thing. So again, just really underlines the robustness of our financial management and our ability, hopefully, to weather any storms that may arise in the future. We're agreed? Good. Then let us move on to the next item, which is still, I think, is it not? No, we've got a change of, well, I don't know how between the two of you you're going to manage this, because it's a joint recommendation. Are you going to do a double act between you? Councillor Isaac looks as if you're going to lead off here.
As you can imagine, leader, we're seamless on this. this is a very positive initiative, I think imaginative and innovative for this part of the country. It is a proposal to establish an investor grow fund by the council. And that's the allocation of £25 million of the funds that are currently referred, that we've been, that Councillor Tait has been referring to, that the council holds in an investor growth fund. The primary purpose of this fund is to invest in Basingstoke in particular, and to help generate, act as a catalyst to generate new jobs, new homes, regeneration generally, and renewable initiatives, renewable infrastructure. It's timely, I think, given all the uncertainties that you've referred to that are going on in the country at the moment with following Brexit. It's an opportunity for this council to make our money work harder on behalf of our residents. As we've said, there's pressure on our revenues, and so if this is successful, I think it can help enable us to maintain important services. What we are looking at here is investing in projects either through loans or equity direct investments to build houses, new offices, commercial premises, etc., that will bring prosperity and jobs. And I think over the period of that's envisaged of this fund, over 10 years, idea is that we will be recycling that £25 million of initial investment, and so it will have a multiplier effect over time. And also, I hope that it's going to leverage in additional funding from a private sector and possibly other public bodies such as the LEP. I'm very pleased that this report, which was tabled to the Audit and Accounts Committee yesterday, received their full endorsement across party. The plan is that we would bring forward to full council an investment strategy to be approved by full council, that there would be an annual business plan approved by cabinet, and that there would be quarterly monitoring of the performance. And clearly the investments are going to be very rigorously risk assessed, and we will be investment decisions that are taken will be based upon the advice from an independent appointed fund manager. The idea is that if all goes to plan, that we would launch this in autumn of this year. I don't know if you want me to deal with the recommendations or whether you would like to do that.
I'll do it at the end.
Fine. Okay, that's all I need to say.
Thank you very much. Councillor Tait, do you wish to add a few sentences?
Thank you, Leader. Just as a comment, I fully endorse what Councillor Ryder has put forward. I mean, it's testament to the fact that we have historically had robust financial management, which puts us in a position to build such a fund. And the use of the fund to grow the economy and grow the opportunities within Basingstoke and Deane, I think is a very valuable tool for the future, which is much needed. So yeah, fully endorse the proposal that's been put forward.
Anybody else? Good. Well, in that case, we can move to the recommendations, which are in two parts. The first part are recommendations that Cabinet approve a number of issues, and then the second part is recommendations that Council, we make recommendations to Council to approve a number of issues. Those which we are being asked to approve ourselves is firstly the establishment of an Investor Grow Fund, as detailed in the report, and to endorse the fund vision and why we're doing it and the principles behind it. Secondly, to delegate the detail of the setup to the Executive Director for Finance and Resources, and in conjunction with the, consultation with the portfolio holders who have just proposed making this proposal. Thirdly, to approve the proposed scheme of delegation to the Executive Director of Finance and Resources for the administration of the fund, noting this will operate within council-approved InvestorGrow investment strategy. Once again, to note the primary purpose of establishing this fund is to support the council in meeting its socio-economic duties and objectives, and almost inevitably that means within the borough, though it doesn't say so. And then to note the financial implications, the Section 151 officer's comments and the appropriate risk assessment, which is also included in the paper. So those are things for us to approve ourselves. Are we happy to approve those recommendations? And then secondly, we are asked to recommend to Council the InvestorGrow Fund investment strategy included in the papers, and the allocation of the alternative investment strategy fund of £25 million to that InvestorGrow Fund. I think it's worth pointing out that this is an initial investment. If this fund grows as successfully as we hope it will do, the fund itself will grow over time, but there's nothing to preclude us from making further investments if we believe that to be the right thing to do as we progress. So we're happy to make those two recommendations. Good, then I think we can conclude that that is agreed. Then back to the agenda. And we move away from financial matters and investment matters to, well, I suppose there are still investment matters, the implementation of an affordable housing scheme at Sandringham Court in South Ham. It's a joint recommendation again by both the Deputy Leader and the Cabinet Member for Property and Development. I think you're going to lead on this, are you not, Councillor Isaac?
Thank you, Leader. Yes, this is another welcome proposal to provide more affordable housing to meet our residents' housing needs. It is a sort of technical property matter, really, in that it involves the release of a restrictive covenant on land at Sandringham Court, South Ham. That restrictive covenant is currently in the favour of the council and restricts the use of that land for hostel use. By releasing this covenant, it will enable the Affinity Sutton Housing Association to proceed with a planning proposal for 14 affordable rented houses. The former hostel on the site has been removed, and the users of the hostel have been rehoused. So the building's been vacant since 2015. Another positive aspect of this, which has enabled the development to take place and which is inward investment into the borough, is that we've received a grant from the HCA of £455,000, or Affinity Sutton have, in order to enable this to take place. So we are looking to execute this in accordance with our council plan and our housing strategy, on the basis that it will promote and improve economic and social and environmental well-being. And I think, yes, the covenant is going to be revised to allow affordable rented housing only in future on the site. So I think that's all I need to say at this point.
Thank you very much. Deputy Leader, would you like to comment as well?
Yes, thank you, Leader. Welcome this proposal on a couple of fronts, actually. First of all, obviously, very valuable affordable housing delivery, which we know we're short of at the moment. So this is excellent. It's fairly remarkable to receive a grant of that size from the HCA at the moment as well in the current climate. So that's quite an achievement also. And of course, worth noting that we will have nomination rights for local people for the houses that are delivered there as well. So that's all a good news story, I think. And then just some context for what happened with the Sandringham Court, which was there originally. When Hampshire County Council came forward with plans to reduce funding on supporting people in 2014, spring, summer 2014, we obviously started to look at what we could do to help and support and to replace, in some cases, the funding that was going on there. Affinity Sutton took the decision very early on that they could not deal with the uncertainty of negotiations with Hampshire, which went backwards and forwards a fair amount as to how much funding there may or may not be. So they decided very early to withdraw from that. But obviously we continued with the Supporting People programme, and we were able to secure May Place as a Basingstoke hostel rather than the regional hostel. Joshua Tree to remain open as very important temporary accommodation. And then obviously we have ongoing work on homelessness and rough sleeping, which is receiving national attention for its innovation. So whilst it was obviously a shame that we lost Sandringham Court, which was provisioned for single homeless women, they were thankfully all rehoused. And really the second best outcome to retaining that provision is obviously to have the affordable housing on the site, which we have achieved. So it's a good news story all round, I think, that we'll actually be able to provide that for local families who are in need of affordable housing.
Councillor Isaac, do you want to come back?
Thank you very much. Yes, just one quick point, and that followed an email I had today, and I omitted to state earlier, is that these proposals do have the full support of the local ward councillors, Councillors Keating and Reagan, and I'm pleased that we've got that sort of cross-party support for these proposals.
Excellent. Good. In which case, members, we're asked very simply to approve the revision of the covenant at nil value and to delegate the detailed terms and conditions to the Executive Director of Finance and Resources in consultation with the Executive Director of Borough Services and the Head of Law and Governance. So I think we should all be happy to approve that. Yep. Then let us move on to an associated paper, which is the disposal of the former Paddock Road surgery site. The recommendation again is a joint one between the Deputy Leader and the Cabinet Member for Property, and I guess being property, the Cabinet Member will, responsible for that will lead on it.
Thank you, Leader. Yes, again, I think this is another positive development for the borough, again, in relation to provision of more affordable housing, or shared ownership housing in this case. This report concerns two separate sites. Firstly, the former surgery on Paddock Road in South Ham, where we are seeking authorisation to enter into an off-market conditional contract for the sale of the council-owned site to enable Sovereign Housing to progress with a planning application. Once they got planning permission and the contracts are signed, to pay an agreed sum, which is features in the pink papers, and that will be for development of shared ownership housing of between four and five houses. Coincidentally, Sovereign own Adelphi House in Church Square in the centre of Basingstoke, which they're interested in. They've been interested in selling. And officers are recommending that we look at the opportunity there, because it's so strategically placed in the centre of Basingstoke. It's a 0.38-acre site. And so we have this report proposes that the council, subject to further work being done by officers and recommendations and being brought back to Cabinet, that we enter into a conditional contract to purchase Adelphi House on terms that have been agreed in principle between the parties. There's no obligation on the council to proceed with this if we don't wish to. So there's further work to be done on that. Just see if there's anything else I need to say. One slight change to the terms that again feature in the pink papers and relate to
in which case we can't discuss
them. No, we can't discuss it, but what I'm saying is that we've seen them and I accept the officer recommendations that they do not make a material difference to the proposal that we have before Cabinet. Just one final point, that in terms of future sales of either site, they will be subject to a restrictive covenant for 5 years, limiting the use of the land for the purposes for which they were acquired. So in the case of Paddock Road, it would be affordable housing. In the case of Adelphi House, it would be for some identified council use at that time. I'm pleased to say that, again, in the case of Paddock Road, these proposals have the support of the ward councillors for South Ham, who both want to see the development undertaken as soon as possible.
Good, thank you. I should have mentioned to members the delicacy of tiptoeing around anything on the pink papers, though I don't think there should be any need to go into closed session, but we can do that if necessary. Councillor Mrs. Reid?
Thank you, Leader. Just briefly, to emphasise Councillor Isaac's reference to the delivery of four or five affordable homes for shared ownership, it can't be often that we might have had two papers coming forward which both put forward schemes for affordable housing. So that is a real plus. And these are for shared ownership, as we said, which is very much in demand. So that's excellent. And as for Adelphi House, well, as Councillor Isaac said, it's a strategic site. It's worth taking an optional note. It's in the top of town, or in the middle of town centre. Could prove a useful site. So it's certainly worth taking the option. And I believe it has a tenant, so it could generate income as well straight away. So it's a no-lose option, really.
Thank you. Anybody else have anything else to add to that? If not, we take that as agreed and done. Then let us move on to the final paper of the evening, which is the adoption of the neighbourhood plan for Overton, a change of portfolio holder now. We move across to Councillor Raffel.
Leader, it gives me great pleasure to put this before you and to recommend that we send this report to full council so that the Overton neighbourhood plan can be made. It's a great achievement for communities to come together and bring forward a neighbourhood plan. It takes a great deal of work, and I know that the proponents of this plan spent a great deal of time working with council officers to get the plan right. When it went to submission at the end of last year, for examination at the end of last year into this year, there were a number of changes that needed to be made, and they were made. And like many great decisions, when they are put to the public vote, when there is a high turnout, even if the margins are close, there is an element of democratic legitimacy which those who find that the result is whatever that is, and in this case is for approval of this neighbourhood plan, we take note of that, and we'll look forward to the council making this plan so that it will become a useful planning document to inform planning decisions for Overton into the future. Just if any of you want to see the complexity of the decision-making process that they had to go through, you should look at the flow diagram on page 10, where they had to go through site after site to narrow things down to the eventual proposal that was put forward. So it gives me great pleasure to recommend this to the Cabinet.
Thank you, Councillor Raffel. I think I would endorse those sentiments wholeheartedly. This is the second one we've had now, following on from the Oakley plan, and there are, I know, quite a number still in the pipeline at different stages of development. But what is really good is that we've started to see the start of that flow, and I hope that sort of gradual drip of these plans turns into more of a gush as we progress down the way, because it is, I think, essential that local people have the opportunity to have a voice and in the way that their local area will be developed within the context of the overall plan for the borough overall. So, very much, I think, warmly endorsed is this one, and recommend we'll go forward to council. That being the last paper on which we are asked to conclude anything this evening, we can bring to an end this meeting of the Cabinet, and thank you all very much for attending, audience. It's very nice to see you.